Our next speaker for today is Dr. Anne-Marie Martin. She is the Assistant Commissioner of the Offender Management Programs from Corrective Services, the Department of Justice. For almost 20 years, Dr. Martin has worked within the criminal justice system in South Australia and New South Wales, and prior to that with the Royal Australian Air Force, including child protection, sex offender treatment, and provision of psychological services. She's got a formal qualification in clinical psychology, and she joined Corrective Services in 2013. And since then, she has had oversight of all correctional centres in New South Wales, its prisoner classifications, placements, chaplaincy programs, services, as well as the victim support unit. I've had the privilege of working with Dr. Anne-Marie Martin over the last 4 years, primarily putting together education programs to reduce recidivism in our state, and especially building programs for incarcerated women, which is also our Premier's priority. Please welcome Dr. Anne-Marie, who will be presenting Women in and Corrections. Welcome, Dr. Anne-Marie.
Thank you, Carla. I hope you can hear me. I'm just going to try to share some content from my screen. I shall, I'll just wait 1 second. It's just coming through. Just wait 1 second, and can somebody let me know if you can see this?
Yes, all good to go.
We can see it.
Thank you so much. So before I get started, I will acknowledge the custodians of the land that I'm meeting upon today in the beautiful city of Sydney, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, and pay my respects to elders both past, present and emerging, as well as any Aboriginal people joining in with us today. And thank you, Ariel, for the welcome to country at the beginning of this particular get together. Yes, as Carla said, I've been working in the corrections sort of area for around 20 years, and it's been my privilege to work in this area with people serving orders and to work alongside of a range of professionals in different disciplines and high-performing men and women as colleagues. We are part of the broader Department of Communities and Justice. And therefore, we are not as large an organisation as, say, health or education, but we do have a large number of staff across courts and tribunal services, community services, as well as our broader infrastructure support services and corrective services in this space. These sort of figures that I've got here before you are just on Corrective Services New South Wales statistics. So we have around 9,500 staff. We do have some temporary appointments, and obviously in the custodial prison land, on every day we have a range of both casual prison officers as well as temp staff being called in to maintain our system, including in non-uniform roles. We have around an 8% vacancy rate in our roles at any one time across our whole agency. Within the particular staffing groups that we've got, it looks fairly okay in some ways. Our high level diversity statistics here, you know, 45% women, 32% in leadership roles. We've also got around 4% reporting with a disability, and not so good in terms of Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander employees within corrective services as a whole. And that is an area of focus. But as you can imagine, the idea of working within prisons, as well as in the back in the background in terms of Aboriginal deaths in custody and the way a government has treated Aboriginal people over time, it's no wonder that many Aboriginal people do not want to work with corrective services, because it does bring challenges for them at the personal and community level. When we just look at women within corrective services, you can see that there's a large number or a higher percentage of women employed in what could perhaps be seen as more traditional roles for women. So very much, if you look at the sort of history of employment of women over time, they've tended, and I'm talking more broadly now with the history of Australia, they've tended to occupy more administrative type roles, often part-time, not full-time roles. This has changed over time. And often they've had greater transitions in and out of work than men. Within corrections, you can see part of this still showing, strategy and policy, doing a lot of administrative support for the commissioner role. Community corrections has traditionally had a greater focus on the welfare of people completing orders, and we have a higher, much higher number of women in that operational area, 74% within offender management and programs at the team that I lead, and around 61% in governance and continuous improvement. And in that space, there is a large group association associated with undertaking performance standards, addressing misconduct, as well as contract management. If you look at the areas that are more focused on working in prisons and more uniform sort of roles, then you can see it's much less in the numbers of women in frontline prison-based roles. So under 40% in custodial corrections, security intelligence, that includes our sort of frontline immediate response groups, as well as people analysing behind the scenes, phone calls, correspondence coming in and out, and industry and capacity. And Carla mentioned before, we have had a great relationship with BSI over time, and it will continue into the future around vocational training in particular. But industries, prison industries in Corrective Services New South Wales has tended to have roles where they've been occupied by people with a particular trade and then receive prison officer training, and they have tended to be men in those roles. So we've got some work to do in this space because women often have a great contribution to provide within prisons, but I'll speak to some of the challenges around that in a few minutes. We've already heard today in terms of reference to the Respect at Work report, and many of you would have read this report. So I just want to touch on a few things within that particular paper. And in that paper, it talks around 33% of people having experienced sexual harassment within the workplace in the past 5 years. And within that group, it's been reported by 39% being women, 26% being men. When we're talking about sexual harassment, includes things like jokes, intrusive questioning, using social media in an inappropriate way, sexually explicit sort of pictures, intimidating type of behaviour, and inappropriate contact in terms of just automatically assuming hugs, touching, and things like that. Within this report, it also details some of the environments that perhaps could be more vulnerable to sexual harassment. And within that, it speaks around unequal staff cohorts, whether that be by gender, race, cultural background, or disability, and also sexual identity. It also talks about a vulnerability being an unequal representation in leadership roles, inappropriate leadership, particularly a heavy masculine sort of macho culture, work that tends to involve non-traditional focus for women. So having roles where women are being pushed more into what would have been seen over time as roles for men. General lack of understanding around respect at work, as well as a strong hierarchical structure. And this is quite interesting because often people would fully know that prisons do have a very strong rank structure. They've been built with the history of Australia. So really, you know, in terms of the first convicts to Australia, in the first instance, largely men, prison wardens, largely men. Hard labour was the real focus in the sort of history of prisons and the management of prisoners at that time. It was only as time went by that we started to have greater number of women, but still at a far less extent to men, and a lot of the policies and procedures in the supervision of male prisoners have still been applied and not adapted for female prisoners. Similarly, in terms of the way that we work is often based on the knowledge and experience of men in the workplace, not of women. And this is really challenging for women in the workplace because generally, for example, I mentioned earlier, I was at Goulburn a couple of days ago at the morning parade. There was probably around 70 to 80 staff lined up for the morning parade. Under 10%, I quickly counted, were women. There was only one woman in the senior management structure there. At many prisons, we don't have any women in the senior leadership roles, and in many centres there's also a reluctance by women to put their hand up to be in senior correctional officer or in management, operational management type roles. Across New South Wales, government agencies are required to undertake a people matters employee survey. So the last survey where corrective services had staff complete this, we had around 65% of staff complete this. And whilst the statistics weren't the same as the Respect at Work report, what was noted within that was around 29% of employees have experienced bullying within the workplace, 9% reported experiencing sexual harassment, and 11% had reported experiencing threats within the workplace over the last year. Now, I truly believe that's probably an underrepresentation of what's going on because there's good reason why some people won't report what's actually happening. So we actually have a lot of work to do, and there are some great initiatives starting to occur across corrective services. In the preparing for today, I did ask a staff member, you know, if women were, frontline women were recognised and valued more, what would that mean? Or how would that be shown in the workplace? And this lady was more than happy for me to share her comments. And she just simply said women would feel more empowered and like they had some agency in their own way, in their own workplace to affect positive change. We would end up generating a more supportive environment instead of one where we feel a need to tear down each other. It would be nice to embrace what we bring to the male-dominated environment instead of being punished or ostracised for it. And that's just one comment, but it has similar themes in terms of what some women are saying in prison officer frontline roles, as well as non-custodial frontline roles, occupied women in prisons. The thing is that women need to be really conscious of their environment, the regime in which they work, their procedures and their particular role. They need to build collaborative relationships and build trusting relationships with their female and male colleagues in order to feel a positive contribution and to feel safe in the workplace. Because the reality is, as soon as you step forward through the door of a prison, everything is controlled. You know, by the time you work through a gatehouse, every single door that's opened or shut, how you watch through the various cameras, it is all securely controlled and supervised. And there can be challenges if there's problems with workplace relationships. Women also need to address misconduct that does occur, but for some of the reasons I said previously, they don't. And one of the challenges is that a professional standards line of addressing misconduct takes time. It involves interviews. It involves collecting a whole range of evidence and testing things out. It requires putting forward allegations and offering procedural fairness. And sometimes, particularly with serious matters that also involve the police, it can take years before something is resolved. Ultimately, all staff, men and women, just want to feel safe in the workplace. So they don't necessarily want to go down a misconduct line. They just want the behaviour stopped. And so we are doing more work around the restorative justice and more just redressing harm in the workplace alongside of our more formal procedures. For me, as a leader, you know, day to day, you have to be aware of your own views, the views of the minister, of the community, of the commissioner. Your day, every day, you're changing your priorities to help support the team as well as government priorities. You're aware of what's happening in the media. And, you know, you just have to be really courageous, have a clear sense of purpose, take good self-care, and know your own leadership style and celebrate and promote that, right? Because we are all different. Men and women, we're all different, but we all have something great to bring, and that's something really, really special. For me, coming to Sydney, around 8 years ago, it was a huge challenge after working in corrections in South Australia, where there's only around 2,000 prisoners. Here we've got about 13,500 people in custody. I didn't know anyone here at all. I was coming from managing a couple of hundred people to around 1,000 people in the team. I had some challenging personal situations. You know, I bought a house that needed renovated. I trusted a colleague in terms of a builder, ended up being linked to an ICAC inquiry because that builder was completely corrupt and getting kickback money coming through to them. I also had a serious health condition, which led to the commissioner and I having a conversation around this sort of arrangement can't continue, because I was on dialysis 3 times a week before having a kidney transplant. So there was just a series of things that happened here. And ultimately, I just had to focus on why am I here? Right? I'm here because I actually believe in the role and I believe in myself and I can do a good job and I can help people. That's what I'm here for. And I'm really lucky to have that. I'm lucky that I love my job. And I think it's really special in terms of what we all do. I've got a little picky here of my dog. That's Jasper. He was a rescue dog. He's now 12. And for me, where work hours can be incredibly long, these sorts of roles can have an impact on relationships because you're not home much. You're expected to be at work whenever there's a need. And things like a dog or sports regime are incredibly important to keep healthy alongside a basic lifestyle things like, you know, hygiene and sleep arrangements. So for me, I have quite a strong regime, not only at work, but also in my personal life to be the best that I can be personally and professionally. These are some of the things that I just wanted to touch on before I finish when I was making comments around culture and workplace safety and wellbeing. Corrective Services does have government priorities around reducing reoffending by 5% by 2023, and there's enormous work happening in that space. But ultimately, we will not be able to help people in our care and people completing orders unless we also believe and show respect in each other. And so there's a lot of work happening now in terms of training. We're bringing management together, investing in skill development around how they should be giving feedback, hearing feedback and being responsive to that, being aware of biases in the workplace and how that might affect the way that they behave, really focusing conversations so that they truly listen when somebody says something, not make assumptions, and respond in a rewarding manner. We're looking at our recruitment processes. There have been concerns around nepotism in the workplace over time, so increasing a lot of transparency around both promotional and new people are coming in. We've got a lot of work happening around resilience, both through our staff mentoring type program, as well as engaging external partners to help with our teams. And this has been really supported, unfortunately, by COVID. COVID, even though it's been a devastating thing and quite a challenge for prison management, because it's meant across Australia at times, prisoners had no contact with significant others. But what that meant was we very quickly introduced some technology that we haven't had before, like tablets, where people can actually see their loved ones at home for visits rather than an in-person visit. And that tablet and the new technology has also now enabled us to start to reach out and have access to secure connections for staff to also have greater support in the workplace. So ultimately, I just wanted to share a little bit about myself, what frontline staff are experiencing, that we're doing a great piece of work. We have got a long way to go. Like what Lisa said, sometimes it's about, you know, the unexpected and how we work with that, that can really be a game changer. And I think the things that are being reported to government within my particular workplace are a real opportunity to make it a more inclusive workplace for the future. And I'm excited by that. Thank you, Carla.